Julian Ongpin, son of one of the country's richest tycoons, is asking a La Union court to dismiss drug cases filed against him. This is in relation to the illegal substances found in a hostel room where he and artist Bree Honson stayed. It's also the room where Honson was found dead. And this morning, we now have his lawyer, Attorney Dennis Manalo. Attorney Manalo, good morning to you.
Good morning as well, Karen, and thank you for having me.
Okay, I think the question first on everyone's mind is Julian Ongpin even in the country? Where is he?
Julian Ongpin is in the country right now, and he is with his father.
Okay, so rumors that he had left, he'll be whisked away. At one point, he will not be facing these charges are all untrue.
Yes, these are all fabricated and nasty rumors intended to demonize my client, Julian Ongpin.
All right, you are asking the court in La Union to defer the arrest warrant. Now, in layman's terms, we have to remember, we have viewers who are watching who would not be an expert in terms of the technicalities of the law. But for a regular viewer, this is what the news has articulated that has happened. Bree Honson was found dead in the room where she and Julian Ongpin were staying. And number two, 12.6 grams of cocaine or illegal substances were found in the room. And under the law, above 10 grams would be unbailable. So questions arose. Why wasn't he detained? Why was he even granted bail? Let's start with that premise first.
All right. Why wasn't he detained? The reason why he was not detained, according to the prosecutor, is that when Mr. Julian Ongpin was arrested, he was arrested for the possession of the cocaine. And when the prosecutor looked at the evidence of the case, he saw that the cocaine was not in the possession of Julian Ongpin when he was arrested. And so he was not caught in flagrante delicto or caught in the act. Because when you are going to make a warrantless arrest, it has to be in the act, or you are committing a crime in the presence of the police. And this was not the case. In this particular instance, the cocaine was found in a pouch on a bed in that room. And when that search took place, Mr. Ongpin was nowhere near that pouch, nowhere near that room. And therefore, you cannot proceed and file a case in court to get a warrant for his arrest. And in this particular instance, what the prosecutor did is to refer the case for further investigation. That means it had to go through preliminary investigation. So to me, it is a justified release insofar as Mr. Julian Ongpin is concerned. That is the procedure. It is not a special case. It was not a special accommodation. It happens in all cases, regardless of the stature of the person being investigated.
But Attorney Manalo, won't this still be considered constructive possession of the drugs? Because Julian Ongpin had dominion and control over the place where it was found. In other words, he and Bree were staying in that particular room.
All right. Before I respond to it, I just want to be clear that Mr. Ongpin is not out on bail. We are not yet even on that stage, right?
Definitely. That's
one. He's a free. Yeah, he's a free man insofar as the case is concerned. Uh-huh. Now, on your question regarding the application of constructive possession, That is precisely the theory that is being espoused by the investigators from the Department of Justice, that they believe that the theory of constructive possession applies in the case of Mr. Julian Ongpin. All right. First of all, what is clear from that theory is that Mr. Ongpin was not in actual possession. Right? So that settles that. Now, next is, since he was not in actual possession, was he in constructive possession? The theory is that it was found in a room.
Yes.
That was where he and Bree were together. All right? Now, that theory applies in cases where dominion and control is clear. In this particular case, first of all, this is a hotel room. And definitely, the nature of your stay here is transient. You are not permanently staying here. And what does that imply? It implies that there were other people who used to stay in that room.
Oh, but yet, Attorney Manalo, this is already a stretch. I mean, I wouldn't think you would go this far.
Yes, yes.
Let's just stick here to more or less, let's face it.
But let me just, I'm curious.
So two people in the room, you do agree that Julian was staying there with Bree. I mean, is that a fact you're agreeing to? Okay. Yes. So if 12.6 grams of cocaine were found in a pouch, let's just be, don't hit me with technicalities here. Who owned the drugs?
All right. What I can tell you based on the evidence, because that's the only thing that I can cite. I cannot cite anything else.
But who owned the drugs? Who
it
owned
does, it? It does not belong to Mr. Julian Ongpin.
Okay.
I do not know who owns the drugs. I cannot say it because I do not have the evidence for it. The evidence that I have says that it does not belong to Mr. Julian Ongpin because that is already a fact contained in the records of the case.
Okay.
If you will notice, let me just add a certain crucial detail here. When the police investigators saw that pouch, that bag, they actually declared in their statement that we decided to open the bag to determine the ownership of the bag. So they wanted to find certain identification materials inside the bag.
Mm-mm.
And they did not find anything.
Mm-mm.
So logically,
but who owned the bag? Either of them owned that bag without you having to pin this on Bree Honson, who of course has passed away. Let's just stick with the facts. Who owned the bag?
All right. Mr. Ongpin did not own that bag. He does not recognize that bag. It was never in his possession. He never opened it. He did not. He doesn't know what were the contents of this bag.
Mm-hmm.
That is his position here.
So did Bree Honson own the bag?
Now, as far as our own evidence is concerned, there is evidence on our part indicating that that bag belonged to Bree Honson.
Okay. Now, your client tested positive. He was given a drug test. Actually, Bree and him tested positive for drug use. You are admitting this. You're agreeing to this test.
I am agreeing that a test was conducted.
Okay.
I am agreeing to the fact that benzyl glucanine was found in the urine test, but I am not agreeing to the conclusion that it means that he took cocaine or imbibed on illegal drugs. It
does not follow. So where would that come from? If you agree to the results of the test, then where would he have, where would, I mean, the contents of cocaine come from unless he took it?
Remember, based on the evidence again, Mr. Ongpin, together with the victim, went out with friends on a drinking spree.
Okay.
All right. Now, the investigation indicated that they were imbibing on a lot of drinks, cocktails, in fact, which is a mixture of so many drinks.
Mm-mm.
Now, what were the actual bottles or brands that were used when they were imbibing in all of these alcoholic drinks. Those are material facts that are yet to be determined because it could have affected the urine content of the people involved.
Mm-mm. But then, Attorney Manalo, your client Julian Ongpin tested positive for cocaine use. I mean, I've never taken drugs in my life, but I can't imagine cocaine being in a drink.
All right, Mrs. Davila.
It's okay, Karen. Just call me
Karen. I'm sorry. Karen, the test does not say that you were positive for cocaine use. Mm-hmm. The test says that you are positive for benzyl glucanine, mm-hmm. which is a byproduct of a person who uses cocaine.
Mm.
All right? Is not only limited to illegal cocaine. There are certain products which have cocaine content which could also produce the same result.
Like which products?
Like, for example, coca tea.
Did he take that?
We're still looking at the facts. They went out on a drinking spree.
Okay, so for example, I get you.
Yeah.
So for this case, for his defense, Julian will not even admit to using cocaine. It's different when, of course, you want to defend him against the death of Bree, but he will not even admit to using cocaine with Bree. He will not even admit to that.
Yes, the facts on record right now does not contain any admission on the part of Mr. Julian Ongpin that he used cocaine with Bree on that occasion.
Okay, but you know, you do admit that Bree and Julian had a relationship, right?
Yes, that is also
an intimate sexual relationship together. This is on record?
What is on record is that they were together, they are close friends, all right? And they had an intimate, they committed an intimate sexual act prior to the incident.
Okay, and if Bree was allegedly using cocaine, are you saying that Julian, you're saying in your defense that Julian was not?
What I'm saying is that that is also not on record because there is no evidence saying that Bree was also using cocaine.
Yeah,
there is what you have is a positive result of benzyl glucanine for Bree and for Julian. But what I'm saying is, it does not mean that they were using cocaine. Because there is a false positive. Like in any test, for example, the COVID test, there is a false positive for a COVID test. There is a false positive for a cocaine test.
Yes, but Attorney Manalo, you don't have 12.6 grams of COVID found in a pouch lying around in a room, which they rented together. So I do understand that clearly you have a strategy here. You have a strategy for Julian Ongpin. But there's also the truth amidst the whole legal strategy that you're in. And the truth is 12.6 grams of cocaine were found in a room where they were both staying and his girlfriend is dead. So these are indisputable facts.
Yes.
The question is, what is his role in all this? Okay, number one, basic questions for Julian and yourself. Given that Bree was his girlfriend, he did not know that she was carrying around possibly 12.6 grams of cocaine. Does he know that?
There is no evidence showing that Mr. Julian Ongpin was aware that there was even cocaine inside that room.
Okay. And is Julian absolutely denying that he used cocaine with Bree? If this comes out in court, are you standing by that he has never used cocaine with Bree?
On that night?
On that night?
Yes, I am standing by that.
You admitting that Julian may have or has used cocaine in the past?
I am not aware of that.
What is he standing by since he is your client? What is he willing to admit in court?
All right. Now, let me just be clear on the statements here that that have been uttered in relation to the question that you have propounded.
Surely.
First of all, I do not have any strategy to get Mr. Ongpin off the hook. Okay. All I have is the factual evidence, which you yourself have narrated. What the facts and the evidence say is that there was cocaine found in a room, in a hotel room, which they were renting out for a limited period of time.
Mm-mm.
There were guests who used that room prior to them.
Yeah, right? But are you going to go as far as this argument
say
that a guest would need 12.6 grams of cocaine?
Yes. And let me just say that there is no evidence showing that Mr. Julian Ongpin knew that there was cocaine inside that room, there was cocaine inside that pouch, or that pouch was even with them inside that room. There is no evidence, because let me be clear that when Mr. Ongpin was confronted with that particular piece of pouch, he said that he never saw that pouch ever and he does not own it.
Okay, so here's a basic question for you, commonsensical, because I'm not a lawyer.
Yes, yes.
If Mike Navalio were interviewing you, the line of questioning would be different. But didn't Julian ask for help? Wasn't he the one who asked for help, right?
Yes, he did. He did. He was shouting. In fact, he was not just asking. He was shouting for help.
Absolutely. Okay, and I think this is clear, that Julian made the effort to ask for help, as you narrated now, shouting for help.
Yes.
Given that this is his girlfriend, what did he think? Did she do? What was she on?
First of all, just to answer, what did he think Bree did at the time? All right.
Yeah.
What is clear from his narration is that he was aware that Bree committed suicide by hanging, because when he was unable to open the bathroom door for quite some time, he started to worry because Bree was not responding. And so he went around the hotel room to the window and attempted to see how Bree was doing inside. It was at this point when he saw that there were glass jalousies that were blocking his view. And so he had to break it open. By breaking it open, of course, that will result in wounds in his arms. There were bruises. And when he finally broke this glass window, he was able to peer inside the bathroom and see the body of the victim hanging on the shower rod, the shower curtain rod. And he was also able to see that the rope that was used was a black knitted cloth, which he, as best he can recall, is an undergarment that Bree was using on that particular day or occasion. He was not specific that it was a bra.
Okay.
He was saying that it was an undergarment, a knitted undergarment. Something like the material would be
the underwear,
cotton. Yes,
maybe underwear, like a thong.
No, not a crop top. Actually,
like a shirt.
The one that you wear under the blouse. Under
a
female's blouse. Something like that.
Okay. So he's saying what he saw is
that's what he saw. And just to finish, to finish, at that point, he was still hopeful that he would be able to save the victim in this case.
Yes.
And so he tried his best to untie the victim. And he did it. He was able to do it. By untying the victim, the body fell on the bathroom floor.
Yeah.
And he has a slight recollection of the head of Bree hitting the side of the toilet bowl.
Okay.
All right. And when that happened, he rushed back inside the room to get inside the bathroom. This time, he noticed that the middle part of the door was made of materials that he could kick in through.
Yeah.
And so he kicked that portion of the bathroom door and he was successful in creating a hole under it where his body was able to fit. And at that time, he rushed to the body of Bree and checked on her breathing.
Mm-mm.
When he said he could not feel any kind of breath coming out, that is when he started to shout for help.
Okay. Okay.
And that is also when the security head or the security representative of the hotel heard him shouting and rushed to the room.
Okay. So what's unfortunate is we don't have enough time, but I will speak to you again regarding this because I do believe you do need to be heard. I mean, I believe that to be fair, Julian's case needs to be heard. But very quickly, there's no doubt he tried to help her. That's on the record. And now you're detailing how. But is Julian admitting that he knew Bree was taking cocaine? Why would she do that to herself? Given that he was the boyfriend, there must be some personal knowledge here of the behavior of his girlfriend.
Mr. Julian Ongpin knew that on that particular occasion, Bree was taking medication, antidepressants.
Okay, but she did not take cocaine? What is he saying on the record?
He was not aware that the victim was taking cocaine on any occasion, on at any time on that occasion.
So
there was no narrative of any cocaine use. What was on record was that there was heavy use of antidepressants and there was heavy alcohol drinking. In fact, in one of the CCTV footages that is available to the public, you would see that Bree grabbed a bottle of liquor from Mr. Julian Ongpin. And Mr. Julian Ongpin said that he wanted Bree to stop drinking that night because she already had too much.
Okay. So, Attorney Dennis, before we go, Julian is standing by this narrative that he and Bree did not take cocaine in La Union that night or even before. That's
only the evidence, based on the evidence that is on record, they did not take cocaine that particular night.
Okay. So they did not take cocaine that particular night. And when you go to court, who are you pinning the 12.6 grams of cocaine on? Somebody that definitely owns that.
That is not my obligation to pin the blame on anyone. That is the obligation of the police to find who is the owner of this pouch of cocaine. And based on the investigation of the police, there is no evidence showing the ownership of this pouch.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Attorney Dennis Manalo, it's been a pleasure to have you. Thank you for coming to Headstart. And we will have you again as this case progresses, sir. I just don't have enough time right now.
Thank you for the brief opportunity to explain the side of Mr. Julian Ongpin.
Okay, I'll see you again. I'll see you again, Attorney Manalo. Thank you, sir.
You're welcome.